Good morning and welcome to our service of worship at Christ Church on Sunday the 4th of July. We're so glad that you are able to join with us as we worship our Lord today. Later in the service, we will be looking at the passage in Genesis 15 as part of our series, Living as a Human in a God-Shaped World. And Doug will be bringing us the message from that passage. In that passage, we have those very famous words spoken of about Abraham, but just as relevant to us today as believers in the 21st century, living still in a God-shaped world, but as believers. And those words that Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. It is by believing that we are saved, and we live by faith in our God. But we know, as we come together to worship once again, that actually we have turned away from our God. We have sinned. And as we draw close to God, let us confess our sins and receive his cleansing. Come, let us return to the Lord and say, Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us. Deliver us from judgment. Bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's just take a moment together in silence as we bring before our Lord those things which have separated us, those things that we have said or thought or done, or indeed those things that we have not said or done. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us worship our Lord.
Praise forever, God. That is who you are. 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 Even when, and even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. You are in moving. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you.
After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, what can you give me, since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, Look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. Abram believed the Lord, credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I shall take possession of it? So the Lord said to him, Bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, Know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and ill-treated 400 years. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterwards they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your fathers in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking brazier with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, To your descendants I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river Euphrates. this land of the Kenites, Kenizzites, Kadmonites, Hittites, Perizzites, Rephaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. Today we're looking at the story of Abram, or Abram as he was at the time, and when he received the promise from God and what happened next. Now, Jordan Peterson is a Canadian psychologist and philosopher. When asked, "Do you believe in God?" his answer is invariably, "I don't like that question." The reason he gives is that understanding the answer depends both on the definition of belief and of God being accepted and understood both by him and his questioner. He says that he acts as if God exists, but is terrified that he might. In an extended version of his answer to this question, Peterson in effect says that belief in a God of ultimate goodness and ultimate power would mean that we could only strive to be perfect in our belief and actions towards him. This is my interpretation of a very erudite but complicated answer. Peterson roots his thinking in the Hebrew scriptures. In particular, he has been critiqued by Daniel Burstyn, who argues that Peterson's views on religion reflect a preoccupation with what Tillich calls vertical or transcendent dimension of religious experience, in other words, upwards, but demonstrates little or no familiarity or sympathy with horizontal dimension of faith, which in particular demands social justice in line with the tradition of the biblical prophets. In other words, how our faith relates to other people. So you could say he's more heavenly minded to be of any earthly use. Peterson, it seems to me, is so logical and open-minded about the possibility of God, and so needful of evidence, that the pure awesomeness of God prevents him from truly believing the mystery, and it remains a mystery. Peterson is a very clever man and may be overthinking what is asked of him. He would no doubt dispute this and argue very cleverly that I'm wrong, but he's not, as far as I'm aware, listening to this. We'll just leave it there. For us, the question is this. It should be much more straightforward. Do you believe in God? Do you accept Jesus as your Lord and Saviour? This is a simple yes or no. A yes has certain consequences, which are all good ones. A no, well, that makes you God's work in progress. I once got in trouble for my sending church's vicar for preaching that we are either Christians or not yet Christians, on the grounds it made a visitor he was sitting with feel uncomfortable. The context was that I was making a comparison with the assessment of MVQs, which I used to do for accounting technicians, and there were two assessment levels. It wasn't pass or fail, but it was competent or not yet competent. The idea being that the purpose of the training is to move towards competence in a particular task. You either were there or you weren't yet there. The inference being that in the future you could well be. In my sermon, I was trying to indicate that God's call to discipleship and belief is on everybody's lives. We are either Christian or not yet Christian. Because, of course, we will all face the judgment seat. In a 2017 interview, Peterson was asked if he was a Christian, and he responded, "I suppose the most straightforward answer to that is yes." It may be that Jordan Peterson has found the answer to the question he does not like a bit more straightforward than he had made it. And Jesus certainly thought It was a straightforward question. In John 6, we find this, verse 28. Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" And Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe? Believe you. What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So they said, "Always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Now, there are three things about this encounter. The bottom line is believe in Jesus. Secondly, don't worry about the things of this life. The rewards are to come. And thirdly, it's the Father's will that all will be saved in this way. Jesus sort of captures this idea in Matthew 6. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal." Treasures in heaven are in God's currency, faith, obedience to his commands and worship, belief in the one he sent. This is what we were made for. We go back to the Genesis story in Genesis 1 and 2. Being right with God, which of course all went wrong in Genesis 3. On a human level, however, it might not be quite so straightforward, this thing called belief. I was listening to a program on Radio 4 called Made of Stronger Stuff. They were talking about perception, and apparently 90% of what we perceive through our eyes actually comes from our brains. The messages captured by our eyes themselves only account for about 10%. And they wanted to show that our brains like certainty and are most likely to assimilate information based on what we already know. Our brains interpret new information within the existing framework. The presenters demonstrated this on radio, because they couldn't show pictures, of course, with an audio example. They played a clip of what sounded like a celestial robotic sound that was sort of indecipherable when you first heard it. They then played it again and were told to listen out to the words "green needle." Sure enough, this time we heard the words "green needle." But next time, they played the same clip. Instead, this time, we were listening out for the word "brainstorm." Sure enough, you guessed it, what we heard was "brainstorm." So our brains were fixating on what had been suggested to them, because that was the certainty, and they built that into the framework. In other words, that's what we actually heard. So bringing these two ideas together, it leaves us with two aspects of the human condition. Firstly, Jordan Peterson overthinking the implications of what "I believe in God" means, meaning that he cannot bring himself to do so unconditionally. And secondly, the human disposition to perceive things that fit within our existing framework. Therefore, our beliefs will be swayed by the things that we already believe or perceive. Neither of these describes the God of miracles, the God of grace, or the God of mercy. He speaks promises over our lives and gives us the gift of faith. Neither of these describes Abram's encounter with God in chapter 15 of Genesis. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. So firstly, God is speaking to him. Notice the direction God spoke to him. Do not be afraid. I am your shield, your very great reward. So secondly, notice what was spoken, encouragement, affirmation, an offer of protection and a promise of gain. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? Next, Abraham has doubts. What can you give me? You say reward, but I don't see how that can be. How often have we thought, God, how can you sort this out for me? I had a conversation with someone this week. Their concern was that we don't have the people for a certain activity. And my response was, but we have a big God. Let's ask. God does not give up on Abram, despite his doubts, questions, and lack of trust. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. And he took him outside and said, Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said, So shall your offspring be. Thirdly, God, instead of dismissing Abram's doubts, makes a promise. The promise on which the other promises we find in the Bible stand, which will come later. You will have a son. You will have descendants, as many and varied as the stars in the sky. And now comes the crucial bit of Abram's fulfillment. No courses, no MBAs or PhDs to study, no acts of penance to earn God's mercy, nothing more than a simple act in verse 6. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Abram believed God's promises. This made Abram right with God. That is how he was made to be right with God. It's how we are made. It is what Adam and Eve had in the garden before they fell. To be right with God is how we're made. And our part is just to believe the promises God makes to us. Now, this is an outrageous claim to Abram. You will have descendants, children. He was too old. His wife was too old. They had tried and nothing. They had long since given up. Abram's framework in his brain patterns was that this was nonsense. Mary had the same feeling, I'm sure, about bearing a son born of the Holy Spirit. Joseph the same about his fiancée's mysterious conception. It doesn't compute. What about Noah's sense that boats don't belong in the middle of a desert? The list goes on. But when God speaks his promises, our brains might want to hold on to the certain, previously known framework, but somehow God's authority overrides that. Abram heard the promise and believed. And God credited this to him as righteousness. It was his belief. That was all. The work of God is to believe, Jesus says. Just believe. And believing that promise made Abram right with God. And Paul comes to this idea in Romans 4 and Galatians 3. Firstly, righteousness is not earned like wages, but through trust in God. In Romans 4, verse 18, against all hope, Abraham in hope believed. And then a bit later in verses 20 and 21, yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. When we think about the future, do we hope against hope? Do we trust? After all, England had to beat Germany sometime, surely. But Abraham's hope was not in Gareth Southgate, but in God, who is eternally faithful. Are you fully persuaded that God has the power to deliver his promises? Out of lockdown, for that ministry you feel prompted to follow, in that prayer you have prayed over a loved one for years, that they will come to the Lord. Do you believe that God has the power? Secondly, righteousness is passed down through the generations. Do you understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham, it says in Galatians 3:7. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise in verse 20-29. Do you know that you are a child of God, right with God, when you believe God's promises? All that we have, Sarah and I, will pass on to our children. Well, if they're nice to us, that is. All that God has, he gives to the Son, who is a co-heir with us. There is a kingdom waiting, and we are heirs according to the promise. All we need to do is believe. And then finally, this is available to all, circumcised or not, for the promise comes first, the sign second, for Abram. In verse 23 of Romans 4, the words, "it was credited to him," were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Romans 4, 23-25. And in Galatians 3, he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Now, I stated a couple of weeks ago that the only truly inclusive term is sinner, for all fall short of the glory of God. But God is a faith rescuer, faithful rescuer. Another inclusive term is invited to believe, Jew or Gentile. In fact, Jew plus Gentile is all humanity, and that means receiving a down payment on this inheritance for all who believe. That is his Holy Spirit, the Spirit who helps us to stay right with God and to grow in holiness. Now, all this is slightly countercultural. Let me give an example, which is the book Good Vibes, Good Life, which is also titled How Self-Love is the Key to Unlocking Your Greatness. It's a Sunday Times bestseller, and it's by an Instagram influencer called Vex King. It describes itself on the back of the book, be the best version of you that you can be. How can you learn to truly love yourself? How can you transform negative emotions into positive ones? Is it possible to find lasting happiness? And it goes on to say that you can overcome fear and flow with the universe. One of the things that people have said about this book is it's a perfect guide for those who are seeking a way out of darkness and want to live a more beautiful and meaningful life. But we might come back to that later. Now, here are some steps to protect your vibe, according to Vex King. And some of them are really good. Avoid gossip and drama, definitely. Let go of things you can't control, absolutely. Avoid comparing yourself to others. Can't disagree with that at all. Don't be afraid to spend some time alone. Speak kindly to yourself and to other people. Brilliant advice. Stay away from people who drain your energy. I can certainly agree with that. But here are some others. Don't do anything that doesn't feel right. I'm starting to sway into that. Yes, there's something in that, but it's about those feelings which can come and go. Please yourself before trying to please others. Well, that's starting to sound a little bit like be a consumer. There's not a servant heart in that statement, particularly. And then ignore any opinions that don't enhance your life. Well, who decides what's life enhancing? There's one really interesting one. Keep your faith larger than your fears. I think Abraham would agree. Keep your faith larger than your fears. Believe in the one who is faithful. Now, this self-love, this is all based on this idea of being, of actualizing ourselves, of self-fulfillment. And Abraham Maslow drafted a theory many years ago, which is a very famous one, about how people are motivated. And there are various levels, and the top one is this self-fulfillment, self-actualization. And the idea is that we need to satisfy our basic physiological needs first, and then safety, and then the ideas of love and belonging, and then esteem, and having our self-esteem being built up. And it's only when these are met that actually you'll get to the top and people can be the best they can be. And in a business context, this means making sure that those ones at the bottom of the pyramid are met so that people will be most effective and most motivated at work. But what if we apply righteousness to this pyramid, being right with God? He provides everything that could meet our physiological needs, for he is the creator and the provider. He protects. He loves us and calls us children of God. Our love and belonging can come from him if we give ourselves to him. We become sons and daughters. We are part of his family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are part of the body of Christ. And he affirms us in terms of our self-esteem by saying, with you, I am well pleased, before we do anything in return. We see that in Jesus' baptism. And we know that the Father smiles on us because he made us. And so the route to self-actualization has actually got nothing to do with the self at all. He is goodness. Therefore, self-actualization is about being right with him, believing in him, listening to his opinions. And it may not be what we would naturally consider to be life-enhancing, because it probably comes with sacrifice. And it will certainly involve having a servant heart and putting others before us. But that reaps rewards. It might mean asking God what is right, not just what we feel is right. It is about being right with God, being credited with righteousness, God's currency, treasures in heaven. And it's treasure that nothing can debase. It is eternal. It is never damaged. And it's never lost. And all that we have to do is, as Abraham did, believe God's promises. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Abraham's faith. We thank you for that he received this gift. And we thank you that you offer that to us too. For Paul directing us towards Abraham's example. And that follows on to the generations and is available to all. Help us to say yes to your promises today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
1, 2, 3, 4. God is fighting for us. God is on our side. He has overcome. Yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. God is fighting for us. God is on our side. He has overcome. Yes, he has overcome.
We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Carrying our burdens, covering our shame, he has overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. I will live, I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free. God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated. God will shout it out. God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated. Shout it out, yes, God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated. And we will shout it out, I will live, I will not die, the resurrection power of Christ alive. I will not die, I will declare and live.
We pray to the Father, through the Son, in the power of the Holy Spirit. You are Lord of all, worthy of our praise, full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger. Father God, we bring before you our petitions and our prayers. Firstly, we pray for the world. Lord, we give thanks for the development of vaccines and the mighty effort that has gone into administering them. As the UK considers booster third doses in the autumn, we pray for the concerted effort to get vaccines and means to administer them to countries around the world. In particular, Moldova, where Chris Elston, our mission partner there, reports they have had no vaccines, could not afford restrictions, and only basic health services. Lord, help the world, the wealthy advanced nations, to help all countries struggling with this virus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for actions on the environment. We give thanks for a bolder vision amongst world leaders and pray for strength and conviction to follow through on policies to encourage a simpler lifestyle that is kinder to the ecosystems of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift our nation to you. We pray for Her Majesty the Queen, the Royal Family, for the Prime Minister and our government, all of whom have publicly struggled with the stresses and strains of family life we all face. We pray for healing where there is division, for integrity in decisions that are in public and in private life. We pray that you will guide our leaders to the conviction that models that integrity to others, strengthen the credibility of those in public life, and restore trust in the political process and the politicians who lead us in these difficult times. Help us to pray for our leaders more than we complain about them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift our community here in Purley, Kenley, Coulston and Croydon. We give thanks for help that is in offer through Food Hub, Food Stops, CAP, Renew 23, the Refugee Centre, English language courses, Grow Baby, and so many more. We lift to you the work of Christian counsellors here and in the surrounding area. We pray for good mental health in these difficult times and for those who need support, the courage to ask for it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift to you the church. We give thanks forevermore ways in which we and others have found to worship and gather safely. We give thanks for car park worship, for Holy Communion during the week, for the continued online presence and for opportunities for young people to meet at church and in cell and in many more ways. As we await news about lifting of restrictions, we pray for wisdom about how much to do, when to do it, and how to stay safe without fear. Lord, do your work in us that we might be ready to serve you in new ways. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for truth to be upheld in your church. We pray for visitors, bishops, and national leaders. Where you have a new revelation, may that be plain to the whole church. Where your word is unchanging, may that be your conviction on all our hearts. Lord, protect us from the temptation to bend your word to our desires. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, we pray for ourselves that we will have the gift of faith. that we will believe your promises, that we will be credited with righteousness, that we will be right with you, Lord God Almighty, Most High. We lift to you now those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. We pray for your healing, for your comfort, and for your peace. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Lord, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we enter a time of song worship. He has forgiven us by his mercy. He has fed us by his word. And he has received our prayers. I pray that you can now enter his presence and receive the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to live for him, to love for him, for you are truly loved by him. Amen.
Maybe midnight or midday, never early, never late, he gon' stand by what he claimed, lived enough life to save.
I heard your heart, I see your pain, out in the dark, out in the rain, feel so alone, feel so afraid. I heard you pray in Jesus' name. It may be midnight or midday, it's never early.
Again and again. I call out to you.